Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Seeds of Liberty podcast. This is episode 42. As always, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT No Government License. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org. So this week, it's going to be the last podcast of the year, although it won't actually air until after New Year's, but well, tough. But I figured we would try to get one more show in for the year. Dave and Danilo both took the night off. Apparently, freedom is not as important to them as it is to me, but we won't hold that against them. But that's quite all right, because I've pulled some other people in who had nothing better to do tonight. And we're going to try to have a lighthearted episode and try to shine some positive lights on the upcoming year, because we often talk about the negative here. And how horrible the state is and what it does to us. So we're going to try to make things a little happier moving into the new year. So tonight I am joined by one of the members of the Seeds of Liberty Facebook group, Andrei. Hey, Andrei, how you doing? Good.
I'm doing great. Thanks for the invite, Jeremy. I appreciate it. This is the first time I've been on a podcast, so this is really cool. Yeah, I'm excited.
I'm glad you were able to. As I think I mentioned to you and we've talked about before, our plan going into the new year is to try to get some of our members on, hopefully at least once a month, whether it's just to tell their story or just to chime in with what they have to say, because without them, our podcast wouldn't be anything. So we definitely appreciate when people are willing to give us their time. And we also have another new podcaster out, our buddy Merrick VanLandingham, who is starting a podcast. What do you got? One episode in the books now. Gonna have another one coming out soon. I was a really big fan of the first one. It's currently untitled, but look for that. We'll most likely be promoting that heavily in the upcoming year. So Merrick, thanks
definitely
a lot for coming on.
Appreciate that. Absolutely. Thank you.
Oh, no, not a problem at all. Like I said, man, I listened to the first show you guys did, and, a little bit of audio issues, but, I mean, heck, we still have 42 episodes in, so that's not a major issue. The content itself was great. You and Dustin, obviously, you guys are buddies, so you have a good rapport with each other, and, I really like the direction you guys were headed in with that one, so I'm definitely looking forward to see what you got coming in the new year.
Yeah, we've got some pretty good ideas. I wanted to tackle probably what was in my mind the heaviest subject that I could think of right out of the bat, just to make it difficult, and see what we could get out of that. And then, I talk nonstop for like over an hour.
So. Well, hey, when you're passionate about it, it comes easy, right?
Yeah, that's what I do, man. That's what I do.
Yeah.
Well,
It's fun. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, man. I mean, heck, I've said this before. I never had any intention of doing any type of podcast or anything. I was doing work for another website before Dave caught a hold of me, and just apparently he had a plan in his head for a while that he hadn't really told anybody, but he had kind of targeted me and Danilo as people he would want to work with. And just one day after things went south, for the website I was working for, he just reached out to me. He was like, "Hey, what do you think about doing a podcast?" And I honestly hadn't thought anything of it. So I was just like, "You want me to sit down and just talk for a while?" He's like, "Yeah." I'm like, "Okay, I guess I could do that." And I had actually started listening to the Freedom Fiends shortly before that happened. And I had become a big fan of them. And I was like, "Well, hey, these guys could do it. And they sound like they're having a lot of fun. Sure, I'd like to try it." And it's interesting. It's especially if you got something to say, why the heck not? Why not get out there and try it? I mean, if you search Stitcher or iTunes or any of the RSS, RSS feeds or anything like that, or even YouTube, there's thousands of people out there trying this stuff. You might as well, if you got something to say and you think there's a chance anybody will listen to it, if you're willing to put a little time in, why not? It can't hurt. And I've seen some amazing stuff come out of people just by trying, just winging stuff and just saying, "Hey, we'll see what happens." And now they've become successful at it. And it's like, oh, great.
And again, that's the beautiful part of the internet is like you put it out there, and regardless of whether you do any advertisement at all, if it's out there and if somebody wants to find it, it's going to get found. So it never hurts. There's no drawback to it at all.
Sure. and just even hours without much promotion, you know, whatsoever. We just wanted to get some content laid down to get it out there to get started. That's already been listened to by, you know, a couple of hundred times.
Just, yes, there you go.
Yeah. You know, right out of the gate. And I'm like, wow, that's great. That was kind of the impetus of me wanting to do this to begin with, and me reaching out to Dustin, is that this is what I do all day anyway, but I'm doing it one-on-one, either in person or on the phone, you know, discussing these ideals, these things that we talk about, but I'm doing it, I'm having the same conversation 100 different times to 100 different people. I said, what if I could just say those things once and everybody could get to hear it?
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
What a great time saver.
Yeah, absolutely. It definitely, for that type of, you know, if that's what you're looking to do, it definitely makes life easier. Cause I never really considered in those terms, but when I look back on it and all the time I've spent trying to have these same conversations, whether verbally or, you know, or on social media, and you have the same ones over and over and over again. And I know so many people that, like, especially if they're doing it through social media, like, they just have folders of stuff of their own writings that they've copied and pasted just so they don't have to go through the trouble anymore. And yeah. I say I'm lazy all the time, but apparently I'm not, because I don't bother to do that. I actually type out the same thing over and over and over.
That's a definite plus to having a podcast. And honestly, what you were talking about, like copying, pasting things and writing stuff up, and I should probably do that, because I've said the same things I don't know how many times, and I've typed it all. Original content over and over and over again. I wish I could get paid for this, because I do a ton of writing. It's incredible.
Yeah.
I'm only in it for the money, too. So.
Yeah, it's so sad. Anybody who thinks they can get into Liberty for the money is sadly mistaken. It's funny, because I think about these things, and I'm like, yeah, all the time that I've wasted and just not copying and pasting, actually, like you said, you know, writing it out this, you know, fresh every time. And it gets discouraging, but then I have these moments of close to elation, I guess, when you get that one person who actually does respond positively, and it's like, oh, okay, you know what? It's all worth it.
Yeah. It doesn't happen often, but man, when it does, it's a great feeling.
You know, it definitely is. And especially through doing this podcast, I've realized how it's brought it to like a whole nother level. Cause it was always one thing, you know, if I'd run into somebody online and I'd get into a conversation with them, or even meet somebody out in the street and get a conversation, you know, they'd ask some questions and they'd walk off, or they'd walk away saying they were going to think about some things. And that's always good, but it was almost like open-ended. It wasn't, there was no closure to it. I could never see it through to the end. But now through doing the podcast and then starting the group, you know, the Facebook group that went with it, and getting to interact with people more directly who have listened to the things that I and Dave and Danilo have said that we haven't had to repeat over and over and over again. And then having them come to us and give us these positive reactions, and especially having a number of people who have come to us and sent us messages and talked to us in different venues, saying that, you know, they look to us as a big part of the reason of where they are. And it's like, holy crap, man. Like if the thought that I had any influence on anybody is just mind-blowing. And you know,
but dude, that's the prize right there, man. That's you know, that's my goal. If I can do this, and I'm not afraid to talk about pretty much anything, you know, I'll say the things that other people don't want to say, that they're afraid to say in polite company, I don't mind it. But if I put the work into it, if one person comes over to Liberty as a result of that, I'm gonna call that a success, you know.
This guy right here, actually, your group is I don't want to hijack the conversation, because we're having a good conversation.
No, hijack away.
I haven't come to I guess anarcho-capitalism. Yeah, anarchism, really. That's for me, and that's actually been mostly because of talking with you guys and being part of the group and being part of similar groups, which, I mean, it's happened in like the last 6 months. Prior to that, you know, I was real limited government, you know, was what minarchism or whatever, but like it didn't go all the way to the other end until I started, you know, hanging out with you guys and having conversations with you guys and listening to your guys' podcasts and actually being a part of the groups. So it's been fantastic, and I just want to tell you guys that so you guys can get the satisfaction of knowing that you had an impact, you know, on my particular life, and that now I'm turning around and paying it forward as well. So,
oh, that's awesome.
That's great, man.
It's cool.
That's great.
It's phenomenal the way it happens. It's cool.
Yeah. Well, you know the old joke. What's the difference between a minarchist and an anarchist? 6 months.
Yep.
It's
so funny. It's amazing how many people I come across and how true that becomes. I mean, obviously, you know, it's a generalization. It doesn't work for everybody. You know, I have a number of friends who took years and years and years to get to this. But I was the same way. You know, I was a small, you know, I went from being apolitical and apathetic.
And this is where I was in 2012. So,
yeah.
Okay. Hey man, you got to start somewhere.
Yeah, I know, right?
I mean,
Ron Paul, the gateway drug.
Yeah, that's 100%. I've seen a bunch of memes posted. I've seen some posted in Seeds of Liberty too. It's like that's the progression that follows, and it goes in a very, very specific way, and it always happens that same way.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's cool to be a part of it, and it's cool to be at the end of it and realize, looking back, like, wow, I just went, you know, from way over here where I was rah, 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 the government. Now I'm here talking about voluntary interactions between people and how we don't need the state for anything, really.
Yeah. Well, you have to deprogram yourself from the religion.
Yeah.
And I think that where a lot of people make a mistake in addressing statists or mini statists or anything else is they don't approach it from the angle of that being a religion. I mean, when you're taught these things, that these things are valid from the time you're an infant, and then you go into the government education system. That's 15,000 hours of compulsory indoctrination.
Yeah.
Yep.
And people hold that very, very near and dear to their heart. So you do have to consider that a religion. You can't just attack it any more than if you're a Catholic and I just walk up to you and start saying how Catholicism is bullcrap and this and that. That's not going to work, you know?
No, it's true. And the funny thing for me is, you know, as far as interacting with statists and stuff, my biggest beef, with a lot of, you know, even some of my friends, is the way they go about trying to interact with them or just trying to beat them down. I can't really fault them for it because I was guilty of it too. I mean, I went through the first, I mean, I've discussed this before on the show. I went through my first year in anarchism after my, you know, after my 8 month journey from being a Libertarian Party member running for office to meeting my first anarchist who actually introduced me to the word voluntarism, you know, 8 months later when I gave up on the system altogether. That first year was kind of brutal and I was mad as hell. And mostly at myself for allowing, you know, allowing myself to be duped for so long. It was, you know, I was angry at myself for allowing myself to be duped for so long. But I, instead of internalizing it, I just pushed it outwards and I just screamed at everybody and didn't understand why people didn't get this. And, you know, even once I explained it to him, it's like, why don't you get this? And you just want to shake people. And it took me a while to get over that. And then I sat back and thought about it for a while. And I looked around and I looked in the community that I had put myself in. And I looked at a lot of the groups that I, you know, on social media that I was in and all these people I was meeting. And I saw it was a trend with a lot of the younger anarchists or just the newer anarchists where there's just anger. And it's, you gotta be able to get over that and then find a better way to communicate with other people. And it's so funny because so often you run into people and we see it in our group too. You know, there's certain people that are just, they're still on that angry anarchist kick and they just want to, they want to yell at statists. Yeah. You want to yell at statists. You want to call them names. And you also want to be frustrated, which is understandable. But one of the most common phrases I come across is, oh, you know, there's no point. They're never going to understand. And that's like the silliest, when you think about it, that's like the silliest thing anybody could, any anarchist could say. Because unless you were born and raised an anarchist, because I mean, I posit that we were all born anarchists. We just had, you know, the submission beaten into us. Right, yeah. But unless you were born and then raised that way, I haven't come across more than maybe a handful of people in my couple of years on this side of the fence that actually spent their entire lives that way. Yeah. Almost everybody else had to go through the, you know, they went through their indoctrination. They had to fight the indoctrination. So like, I hate when I hear people say, oh, they're never going to understand. It's like, what about you? Where were you a year ago, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, wherever it was? Like, weren't you them at one point? You know? So I think,
That's a very salient point, is that you always have to remember when you were in that mindset. And that's typically the way I try to address issues with people having that discussion, is to talk to them like I would have talked to myself, you know, from years ago. And, you know, in a lot of ways, I've always been an anarchist. I've always had that oppositional defiance disorder. but for a lot of years, you know, I directed that at, you know, we got to get back to the Constitution, you know, limited government. And we want, you know, I want government so small that you can drown it in a bathtub. And I forget who it was that I heard say, I think it was Dobby Barker, said that, well, if you want government to be so small you could drown in a bathtub, how about make it so small that it's only theorized about by particle physicists? And I went, yes, that.
That's actually pretty clever. I do
believe that was a Dobby line, yes. I'm quite fond of that one myself, too. It's true though. I went through it too. As Lou Fien likes to call him, I was a Constitution humper, and I carried one in. I had my pocket one. I carried it with me everywhere. I had I wore cargo shorts.
That one.
As long as I could through the year, just so I had room to always have one in my pockets.
Have cargo pants in the winter months though.
No, I didn't. For some reason, I didn't like those. I prefer jeans when it's super cold. But I always had one with me, and then I kept a spare one in my car. And
do you hand them out? I used to buy them in bulk and hand them out.
Yeah, I got the 100 pack from Cato 1 year.
Right.
And I gave them out. I think as stocking stuffers 1 year. Please, my kids. When they were first, you know, up until they were about, I guess, almost 2 years old, when I finally started openly calling myself an anarchist, before I completely gave up, I was reading them passages out of it for bedtime stories. Like, that's how bad I was.
Sure.
I look back at it now and go, oh, I'm so glad they're not going to remember that because they were too young. Because that's going to be something I'm going to have to explain. Daddy, why were you reading us that? No, never mind. That was a bad phase in Daddy's life. Yeah. Let's just forget about that.
Before I went through detox.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, thankfully I reached that phase of frustration and anger and lashing out back when I was a libertarian, you know, in 2012, 2013. Mm-hmm. Before, you know, I actually had time to settle down and take a look at, like, well, you know, maybe that's not the right approach. And you guys are right. Like, I've always found that the best approach is always to just be calm and neutral and, you know, take things as they come without getting fired up. I mean, I'm guilty of it too. I like taking pot shots at stupid ideas. And I mean, we post memes all the time.
Sure. Exactly.
It's dumb fun. But when it comes to actually, you know, talking about these principles and talking about voluntarism and private property rights and individual liberty, you're right. I try and talk to people the way I would want to be talked to, even if it's horrifyingly frustrating. Like 98% of the time, I want to just like smash my keyboard repeatedly with my fist. But I've managed to get more people to admit to more fundamental things that way than I ever did shouting at people and talking people down. Like, it's incredible. My dad, just to give you guys a little bit of an idea, my family and myself were from Romania. I was born there in 87. Mm-hmm. The dictatorship, the communists fell in 89. And then my father came here, and then me and my mother came here in 91. And we've been here ever since. But I mean, I just as recently as like a a couple of weeks ago when my parents were over here for Christmas, I had a very long and in-depth conversation with my dad, and I essentially got him to admit that, you know, just because the United States is a whole lot better than communist Romania, it's still more or less the same thing. That the soft authoritarianism is only different by a matter of degrees from hard authoritarianism. And I actually got him to come out and say it, which was phenomenal.
Wow.
And that's, it's just about how you frame the message, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, I mean, we ended up getting a little bit buzzed because we had a bottle of whiskey and we ended up, our voice levels got higher and higher. We started, getting, we weren't yelling. We were just getting loud because we were kind of drunk. But yeah, I mean, we got there. I mean, when we got there, because we didn't resort to name calling, we didn't resort to shouting, we didn't resort to making fun of each other at our own expense, and we got there. Like, it was an incredible moment. He still is, he called me the a couple of days after. He's like, be careful. Anarchism has a very, negative connotation. I'm like, yeah, I get it, but it doesn't really matter because I got my point across. So I don't care.
You planted the seed, though, and that's really all you can do. You know that old saying that those convinced against their will are of the same opinion still.
Yeah.
You can't force it down anyone's throat, but you can do it by example. Look at me. I don't have a neck beard. this is a cocktail, not a Molotov cocktail. I'm a peaceful person, and my oldest son's 23 now. He's an anarchist. My youngest son is 6. I'm working on him. He'll be there. I've done the same thing as Andre. I've had over Christmas sat down when my mom was in town, and we had about a 3 or 4 hour conversation. And at the end of it, she said, "I can't disagree with anything that you've said." But then again, before I came in here, the football game's coming on, and she's sitting there with her hand over her heart, pledging to the national anthem. And I went, "Well, okay, there's still work to be done there."
Yeah. Yeah. So. And I mean, we might never eventually get there, with everybody, and that's fine. We don't have to, but that's the beauty. That's the beauty of everything we do is it's all a matter of getting the message out, and hopefully people will latch onto something. Like, yeah. if you chip away just a little bit, if you get like one person to admit to like just one fraction of their view of government authority is, well, that's not really right. That's how I started. That's how I'm sure everybody else kind of eventually ended up there. You went from, well, I mean, maybe they're right. Maybe the government shouldn't be doing this. Well, if the government shouldn't be doing this, then, doesn't the principle apply everywhere?
Sure.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's just, fine.
I don't think I'm ever going to get my dad to think the same way we do, but it's nice to at least make some progress.
You can at least put it out there. That's the best that you can do. You can make a compelling case, and the rest is up to, the person that you're talking to. But, I think 2015 has actually been a good year for liberty.
I think so, too.
It's much more mainstream than it was 20 years ago. I mean, yeah. if you would have self-identified as a libertarian 20 years ago, nobody would even know what the hell you're talking about. It's like, liberal what? You work at a library? It's like, no, I'm a voluntarist. What, you volunteer? And now that's much more mainstream. Look at the volume of media that's on the internet now that is strictly libertarian based, that's anarchist. It's probably 5,000% what it was 10 years ago. That's a good thing. And I mean, look at what's happening with the Free State Project. I mean, that's not that it's not without its problems, but I mean, you didn't see that years ago. So, I'm optimistic.
Well, yeah, and the another example that actually just brought something to mind, the free country,
that's right, the one in Europe
over there, in
Liberland.
Yeah. the Czech Republic, I think, in
right.
Poland,
mm-hmm.
yeah, Liberland. Like, five, six, 7 years ago, that wouldn't have even made news coverage. I wouldn't have been aware of it, but like now, I saw it on my news feed. I saw it, broadcast to at least me, and I'm sure everybody who has even anywhere near similar interests as me, and I share the hell out of it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, that's great. Now, the only problem is the first thing they did when they got there is started talking about, you know, setting up a money and a constitution. I'm like, whoa.
Well, yeah.
you're already perfect right there, man. Just you're good. just stop.
They got excited. It happens. I mean, yeah. I mean, wouldn't you be excited if you found land that wasn't claimed by anybody in Europe? I mean, what land hasn't been claimed by somebody in Europe in, like, the last 5,000 years?
Yeah, no kidding. That was my thought. I'm like, who in the hell missed that?
Yeah, I don't think anybody missed it. Nobody wanted it at the moment because it was...
Yeah, it didn't look that appealing. I looked at some of the aerials. I'm like, I don't know.
Not even the land itself. Wasn't it in between like two warring factions that had just kind of declared it a dead zone for a while? Wasn't that the whole story behind it?
Part of it historically was the case.
So, but yeah, you're right. It's impossible to find anywhere. And I mean, I followed that for a little bit. I think it's funny because, you know, it came across, I mean, obviously it came across all my feeds and stuff like that. And, you know, part of me thought, okay, well, I'm only seeing this because I'm connected with so many other anarchists and we're all sharing the same type of stuff. But that, you know, that story at least actually made some of the mainstream news. Not that I watch any of it, but as far as I was told, it was, you know, there was stories on it on CNN and stuff like that. They were obviously taking pot shots at it and, you know, just giving a brief story and saying, okay. And then, you know, everybody's supposed to just laugh at the idea. But at least, you know, like Merrick said, at least it's out there, you know, and now
in 8 years, it wouldn't have been.
Yeah. I mean, for me, it's hard to look back and really judge. Cause I've, you know, it's only been two or three years since I've been on this side of the fence that I didn't really know much beyond, you know, the appeal to antiquity of government has always existed, so therefore will always exist up until like 4 years ago. Like, I had no thoughts beyond that. So anything prior to that, it's hard for me to look back and try to remember what it was like because I wasn't looking for those things. So I can't really say whether it was or it wasn't. But I do look towards... you know, some of the, you know, the elders in this community who have been, you know, people like Larkin Rose, who's been at this for, you know, almost 20 years now, you know, and when he comes out and says stuff like, you know, it's been amazing, you know, for 15 something years, I felt like I was almost alone in this. And then in the last 3 to 5 years, the explosion has been insane. You know, just like, you know, I remember he did a poll on his page last year at some point, just trying to gauge, you know, how long people have, you know, have been calling themselves anarchist or, being an anarchist or whatever. And the overwhelming majority of people were 3 years or less that commented on that, you know, and there was thousands and thousands and thousands of comments. And, you know, and it definitely seems to be trending that way. You know, so like I said, I can't personally look back and say, oh yes, I've seen it move from here to here, but just in the short time that I've been you know, out there promoting these ideas, I can see my little sampling size and say, okay, I now personally know a hell of a lot more anarchists than I did a year ago, so we're definitely trending in the right direction. You know, and to go back to something you were saying about your dad before, Andre, it's funny because I have a sort of similar situation with my dad. I mean, he was born and raised here, but he was former military, and he was actually the one who sent me. He inadvertently sent me on this path five or so years ago, because he was a Tea Partier. He was a hardcore constitutionalist, and he was very, very, very anti-Obama. Like the whole. He's a Muslim, all the crazy, every wild conspiracy theory about Obama. My dad was flooding my inbox with these things.
And just
kept insisting that I needed to read this and I needed to check into that and yada, yada, yada. And I just, at that point, I was still pretty apathetic to the whole thing. Like, I'd been a Democrat most of my life, but didn't really care, didn't really pay attention, just went and voted in the presidential elections. And then I started to have more... like, I guess I thought I was becoming more conservative once I started my business and realized that, you know, taxes suck and the government's trying to rip me off. Like, when I got my house and then I started my business, I'm like, wow, this really sucks. Like, something's got to be done about this. So I started paying a little more attention, but I still wasn't caring enough to, like, when he was throwing all this stuff at me, I was just like, oh, this is insane. So, like, after a year of him just bombarding me with this stuff, I literally called him one day and said, all right, I'm going to look into all this stuff that you've been sending me, but I'm telling you right now, I'm doing it to prove you wrong, just so I can say you're an idiot, you're crazy, and you're a conspiracy theorist, you're just a whack job. But that's what I'm going to do. And I started digging and started looking into this stuff, and I found out he wasn't exactly wrong about all of it. But then I kept digging and I kept going past the further and further and further. And then I was sending him stuff that he had never seen before, never heard of, stuff from, historical stuff. Mm-hmm. And just be like, hey, well, what about this? Why don't you, you're such a big fan of, Washington and Jefferson. Well, do you know this about them? Like, do you know, like, all these things? And I obviously surpassed him in that aspect. But now I've gotten him to the point where he participates in the group every once in a while. He regularly is on the Seeds of Liberty the Facebook page, liking stuff, sharing stuff from there. I see him sharing stuff from Larkin Rose to all his 3%er and conservative friends.
That's awesome.
And that's fantastic. Hey, good for him.
He told my wife at one point, one of the last times he was in town, they had a conversation when I was out at work, and what she told me was that he told her that he agrees with me pretty much 100%, but he's still stuck in that I can't see it happening, therefore I can't, the whole, basically the fallacy of personal incredulity, I can't see it, therefore it can't be type of thing. And he's still hung up on the national defense issue, which is ironic because that was the last stumbling block for me. And I wasn't military because of him, because one of the things he told me when I was growing up was if I ever, he would kick my ass if I decided to join the military because it was the dumbest thing I could ever do. Because he was a NAM, so.
Sure, as was my dad, and that's the way I was raised. And, he did 3 tours of Vietnam, you stomp my flag, I'll stomp your butt, that type of thing.
Yep.
And that's why I really was kind of that hardcore constitutionalist for so long. But it's funny you said that, because that's actually what did it for me, because I started reading history because I wanted to know. I wanted to bolster my case with historical evidence and perspectives. And as I started diving in, I started studying wars. And because obviously we need this huge defense budget because, we're always at war, trying to protect our borders, protect our people, keep ourselves safe, right? That's what they tell us. And when I got to the First World War and started seeing this international collusion that had no other alternative but to turn into the absolute bloodbath that it was. Mm-hmm. But what most people don't understand is that was really a family feud.
Yeah, because people don't realize people were related.
Yep.
Yeah, Tsar Nicholas and Kaiser Wilhelm were both grandsons of Queen Victoria. Really? This is a family beef, and it ended up killing 20 million people in the beginning, and then with the Treaty of Versailles, basically set up the inevitability that was the Second World War.
Yes, and I just want to say this. It took me a while to figure that out. I love history. I love studying history, but I've never been as historically literate as I've wanted to be, and it's only been recently, the last couple of years, where I've actually sat down and actually taken a look at things with a fresh set of eyes towards, how has government ruined everything?
Mm-hmm.
And you look at the Treaty of Versailles, and you're like, so how could you possibly have thought that wouldn't have led to the rise of a dictator in Germany? Like, there's no other way that would have happened.
No, it was almost like it was there by design. I mean, the punitive edicts in there against Germany, it set the stage almost too perfectly for the rise of some kind of dictator, like in this case, Hitler. So, when I started to make those connections, it really started breaking down, all of my confirmation bias. And then I was just pissed. I said it to myself, I have been lied to. Damn it, my whole life I have been lied to. And I'm like, what else have they lied to me about? So, start researching, George Washington. you know, because he's founder, you know, father of the country and the greatest hero we've ever had, and couldn't tell a lie, wooden teeth, chopped down cherry tree, the whole bit, right? What a freaking tyrant, you know? When I got to the Whiskey Rebellion, I'm like, you did what?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
you raised an army larger than any army you ever raised against the British.
Yep.
To put down, you know, basically people who were committing a victimless crime because you made demands that were untenable. You know, there's a whiskey tax and you're going to pay it in specie. Well, we don't have specie. We trade in whiskey. This is our currency.
This is our
modicum of exchange is this. And they just doubled down on it, and it was terrible. And it's just over and over and over, when you go back and look into history, it was a lie, you know? I used to be very defensive about our involvement in the Vietnam conflict, because remember, that wasn't a war.
Oh, that's right, yes.
And, you know, I was raised up in that environment, until you start looking at, you know, Gulf of Tonkin. Mm-hmm. You're like, wait a minute, they set that up.
Yep.
You know, pretty much any war since the War for Independence, I would say, was a complete sham, just based on what I found reading history. And, you know, I think if we, at least what I do in a part of my outreach, my activism, is I try to share these little things in history that people were not taught, or they were taught some type of revisionist history that's inaccurate, something that always makes the state look good, right? Because, I mean, who's doing the educating? The state. So I just give people historical analysis and say, well, or not analysis, but, you know, instances, and say, hey, you know, I bet you never heard that. Now you can go home and research that one on your own. Come back and tell me if I'm lying, you know? And that seems to open a lot of people's eyes. They're like, well, wait a minute. That's not the story I got. I'm like, I know. That's why I'm talking to you.
or they go out and they're like, oh, well, I'm going to prove you wrong. And then they go,
yeah. And I'm like, please do. That's what I want.
Well, see, no, exactly. Like I said, that's what I set out to do with my dad. My goal was to prove him wrong. That's all I cared about. I didn't actually care. I didn't even really care about what the truth was at that point. My goal was, I was just so frustrated with him sending me this stuff over and over and over again for like a year, that I was just like, I have to prove you wrong. That's all I cared about. And I couldn't prove him wrong. But it, you know, what you said, Merrick, about the history being that in, and just showing that to people. It's funny because there's a one point that I thought that could never work because so many people find history boring. But I think part of that is by design, because, you know, we were just, you know, you go through that indoctrination process and you're just pounded with dates and names. Dates, exactly.
Dates
and names. It's you know, it takes a rare history teacher to make it exciting, to make it interesting, to go out of their way to try. And, you know, all too often, most of us did not get to experience that, at least not, you know, if at all, you know, maybe once or twice, but you don't get that. So I can understand why most people would find it boring. So I never thought of that as like the in for people. But then again, I had to think back to my own transformation, because the same thing for me, I used the history route. And it's funny, you were talking about, you know, looking back at George Washington and getting up to the Whiskey Rebellion. That's actually where I started. That was probably as close to my aha moment as I can pinpoint, was learning the true history about the Whiskey Rebellion.
Sure.
Just because I remembered hearing it mentioned in school, like just offhand, you know, just barely or whatever. And when I came across it the next time, you know, a few years ago, I was like, that rings a bell. Why don't I remember the story behind it? When I started digging into it, I was like, whoa, this isn't right.
This isn't at all what I heard.
This is not how it works. This is not how any of this works. So I had to look at that and go, okay, wait a minute. Maybe this can be, because on the flip side of that, you come across a lot of people that will demand evidence from you. you know, about everything. Like they're because they're well, and I mean, it to a certain extent, you can't blame them because you know if you're just making some wild claim that they've never come across before, to them it's a wild claim. So yeah, you got to have something to back it up.
I mean, that's argumentation and debate.
Exactly. So, but like, but the people people that want like think they can catch you on stuff like this. This is a perfect opportunity. Okay, here's history. Debate me on it. You know, like if you want to argue that, go for it. But one of the other things you said too about the revisionist revisionism, I hate that term because so many people throw that around and they're talking, they, you know, to actually to discredit a lot of this stuff that, you know, the stuff that you're talking about, the stuff that I think a lot of, you know I came across. That's just revisionism. It's like, well, no, what if the actual story was the revision? Because it didn't happen that way. And, you know, when you put enough of these pieces together, it's kind of hard to see it another way.
And you're right about that term. And I'm aware of that. I probably should use a different
term. It's a personal thing with me that I try not to use it because I'm like, it's all revisionism because we don't know. I mean, it's much of the history beyond a couple hundred years. You know, there's little stuff that people have found and tried to piece together. And it's like, we don't actually know about a lot of what happened. So you can only know so much. But I think, I mean, for me personally, that's why I look to, I listen to a lot of podcasts and stuff. And that's why I'm so excited now that there's...
Oh, Dan Carlin's Hardcore History.
Well, yeah, he...
Prof. CJ.
Yeah, exactly. Now, it's funny.
Danella...
Daniele Bellelli. I just started listening to that at actually Danilo's. Danilo suggested it to me because I knew who he was because I listen to the Joe Rogan podcast quite often, and I've heard him on there before. And I always thought he was a really intelligent guy, and I liked what he talked about and stuff. I just never sought his podcast out, but Danilo mentioned it to me the other day, and I just listened to the first two, which were amazing. It's so funny because... Yeah, but it's I was going to say, it's so funny because, you know, a couple of years ago, if anybody would have told me that I would have gotten thorough enjoyment out of listening to history podcasts, I would have told them they were out of their minds.
Have you ever listened to Tom Woods?
Oh yeah.
Yes. It's funny. You know, we were talking about the Ron Paul thing before.
Yeah.
Tom Woods was actually my red pill. It wasn't Ron Paul. It was Tom Woods. Somebody introduced me to Tom Woods. I started reading his books and then I listened to his podcast as soon as it started and everything started falling into place. I'm like, oh my God, it all makes sense. Holy crap.
Yeah. And what I've noticed, and I've listened to all 560 something episodes of Tom Woods.
Me too. Haven't missed one yet.
one of the corollaries I've noticed or commonalities between all of these people, these historians, is, and they really are revisionist historians, is that they use primary sources.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's where the revisionism comes in. I don't remember when I was in the government education system even hearing the word primary source. It's just here's the way it's written and that's the way it was. And you go, oh, okay.
Yeah.
But, you know, when they can go back to primary sources and use that as the vessel to say, you know, this is written by the guy who wrote it, who was standing there, who watched it.
Mm-hmm.
I find that much more compelling. And then guys like that can take it and turn it into a compelling story because it is. History is fascinating. It's better than any movie plot because it's way weirder.
That's why I love history. That's why I love studying history. That's why I love learning about history because there's always something new and interesting to learn. There's always another way to look at something that, you know, everybody tells you, oh, well, it happened this way. Well, you actually dig into it and look at it, it's like, oh, well, there's this, 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 and this that nobody bothered to mention to me and nobody told me about. And it's infinitely cooler than the official line I just got from 5 dozen people over there.
Absolutely. And I think that's a great tool that we have to get people walking in the right direction, you know, planting that seed. It was, I can't remember if it was Tom Woods or not, who eventually spurred me to read Economics in One Lesson by Henry Hazlitt.
Mm-hmm.
What an eye-opener that was as to understanding how economics works. And then, of course, I wanted to know more. So I'm reading, you know, now Friedrich Hayek's The Road to Serfdom.
I read that, by the way. Fantastic book.
It's a great book.
Yet it's great.
You know, and Lawrence Reed's Excuse Me, Professor. You know, just all of those. Bastiat's The Law. I use this one for reference all the time. You know,
yes.
Just and it one goes into another, and then it all starts to the pieces start to fall into place, and you go, ah, it makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. It's you know, like I said, I think the hardest thing for a lot of people is getting them over that history is boring thing and saying, okay, no, let's take a look at this. And you know, that's why I like to start a lot of my conversations. I try to direct them into, you know, I try to drive them in that direction so I can say, well, what do you remember about this? And you know, basically, you know, what do you remember being told about this? And what if I could show you that maybe that's not exactly what happened? You know, and it really is. It's all about just planting the seeds, because you can't, you know, some people are just going to want to deny, but others, if you're even the slightest bit curious, you know, it's the domino effect. It's just that, you know, I say it all the time. I truly believe that everybody outside of those who are completely mentally incapacitated, and those are the true psychopaths. Outside of those people, I think everybody else has that aha moment inside of them. I truly believe that. I believe everybody does, and it's just finding that trigger.
Sure, that's exactly right.
And it's different for everybody. I mean, well, not obviously, you know, there's certain paths that most people will fall into, you know, but there's that slight difference for everybody. It's just that thing. So it's a matter of pointing them in the direction and just getting them thinking. And, you know, I think you said it earlier, Merrick, about just that whole, you know, well, what else I was lied to. What else did they lie to me about? You know, I went through that process too. And, you know, like I said, I got angry, and then I directed it at myself, because I was mad at myself for allowing it to happen, even though, you know, it's kind of hard to see it happening any other way for most people, because not only were you indoctrinated it through, you know, through school, you had your parents and the rest of your family who went through the same process and reinforced every bit of information.
Exactly.
And just said, yeah, no, this is what happened, because
you're getting it from all angles.
So yeah. It's like, you know, so it's hard to see that not occurring in many people. So I think for me, that's when the anger finally started to subside, when I was finally like, okay, I got to step back and say, yeah, this happened to everybody, because, well, it, you know, why wouldn't it? That was the way things were kind of designed,
sure.
You know, you don't have to get crazily conspiratorial to understand that. That's another thing. You know, too many people were quick to say, oh, you're just, you know, it's
tinfoil hats.
Yeah, exactly. But it's like, well, no, because in my mind, it actually doesn't matter. A lot of what we see before us today, I honestly don't think it matters whether it was by design or happenstance. We're in the place now. That's what matters. And whether you can point to a lot of these historical situations that we were told different stories about, if you can, whether you can piece them all together and say, yes, definitively, here's the pattern. This is what has been happening since day one. Or whether you can say, well, some of these happened, but there's not enough supporting evidence to link them all together. Doesn't matter. All these other things did occur. We are where we are now, and those who hold the keys to the power are taking full advantage of it. So, like I said, to me, it doesn't matter. But I think for a lot of people, especially the, you know, there's so many people out there that I think that are really, I hate to say hardcore statists, but well, they're hardcore statists. But they really do have good intentions, and they really do want to be happy and see other people be happy. But they're just, it's that fear that's been pumped into them along with everything else, that when you say anything, even if you present it in the nicest way, even if you wrap the prettiest package and say, here you go, I just want to give this to you, I just want you to take a look at it, you know, they recoil, because it's the unraveling of that sweater, that first thread there. I really believe a lot of people in the back of their mind know that the government being completely corrupt and there never being any chance of salvaging it whatsoever. I think a lot of people actually know that in the back of their mind, but they are so fearful of admitting it that they will find anything to justify it. And
And like we were talking about earlier with national defense, we were saying like that's a big stumbling block. Mm-hmm. I know it's a big stumbling block for a ton of people I know.
Sure.
Yeah. And fair disclosure, I am a veteran. I served in active duty U.S. Army for about 3.5 years. I'm in the reserves now. I was biding out my time because they made me sign an 8-year contract. Mm-hmm. But it's, you know, I approach that subject because one of the things that a lot of people don't realize is, you know, when they talk about, oh, we need defense spending, you know, obviously it doesn't go to defense. It goes to the Pentagon budget, which is a whole bunch of bureaucrats in office, you know.
Yeah.
In office. It doesn't do anything. And like, I have firsthand experience with that, like where we spend countless hours and manpower and dollars to have the same sexual harassment class and the same, oh, you know, you shouldn't beat your wife and you shouldn't beat your dog counseling over and over and over again. In the meantime, oh, well, we can't order parts for our Humvees because we're broke. Because the unit doesn't have any money. I'm like, we're spending like $500 billion on defense and we can't buy doors? Like, you serious?
No, we spent that $1 trillion on the F-35 Joint Strike Fighter.
No, it was the toilet.
The toilets. Yeah, what? Yeah.
And then the other half trillion on the hammers, exactly. Right. And like, and I tell people this, and I hate to say it because it does give me like it does provide me with a credential because people like say, oh well, you were X, Y, and Z, so obviously you know what you're talking about, even though it's not really the case. But I mean, at least in this particular instance, I can be like, well, I was there, I saw it. I can promise you that this whole, you know, if this is a stumbling block for you, I promise you, whatever your preconceived ideas of this from firsthand experience. Not the case.
Yep. It's all fraud, waste, and abuse.
Oh God, it is. It's so bad.
Yep. It's funny that you said that about, you know, having that little bit of credibility. I mean, we've had Donnie Gebert on the show before, who's talked about that it's a lot easier. Sometimes people will take it a lot more. We'll take the information a lot more willingly from somebody like yourself who actually has been, you know, because I get that all the time, you know, when I try to talk to people who have either been in the military.
Why don't you serve?
Not even that. Why don't you serve? The very notion that, well, if you haven't served, then you don't have a valid opinion.
Yeah, that's the worst.
You know,
that's
but I mean, but you see it all the time. You see it with, you know, with everything. You know, the whole, you know, the extreme wing of the feminism culture with the, you know, you're not a woman, so you can't possibly know anything. It's like, no. You can talk about, in any situation, you can just talk about the logic. It doesn't, you don't have to be there. It's utterly ridiculous, but that's a common refrain. But so but it does make sense that people would be more willing to accept certain information from somebody like yourself because you, whether it's right or wrong that they think that way, it does make it easier, you know, so that you do actually probably have, you probably have a leg up on somebody like me being able to talk about stuff like that. But it's funny that, I mean, that is that, like I said, that was my last hang up. It's my dad's currently. It's a lot of, same with me. I know a lot of people, that's one of their hangups. They never see how they could get past, you know, how that could possibly happen. But
won't the terrorists get us if we stop spending money on defense? Like,
well, yeah, maybe if you stop giving the money to the Defense Department so they can create more terrorists, maybe there won't be as many to deal with. But that's just a whole other story. One step at a time with these people.
Yeah, you gotta ease your way into their panties.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Exactly. You know, well, I was just gonna say, for me, the one thing that got me over that hump was Chaos Theory by Robert Murphy, which was basically two little essays that he wrote years ago, and they put together in a book. But it was about how just a possibility of how private law, the basics of how private law and private defense could be handled, mm-hmm. and just reading that was my aha moment. I didn't even have to accept that it could definitely happen that way. Like I said, it's different for everybody, but for me, that's all I needed. I needed to be able to see, holy shit, wait a minute. Yeah, it could work that way. Why couldn't it work that way? Like, and that was it. But it's getting people to that point, which is difficult. But you know, we've said it a bunch of times already. The only thing you can really do with most people is just you plant the seeds, and you know, you hope they sprout. And you know, I've been doing it long enough now that I've had a couple of people come back to me and say certain things, and some people that I never expected to come back and ask me questions, and I'm like, wow, I'm making some progress. So this is great. So it makes it all worth it to me. So that's why I keep pressing on. Why I keep that and my kids, because I got two little girls that I can try to drive crazy with all this stuff for the next few years, and hopefully get them in the right direction.
Well, you know, to give that idea a little bit of redemption too, we start off using revisionist history, you know, real history, to plant the seed of doubt in someone's mind by showing them with evidence that what they've been told was not the truth. And so now you're starting to crack that confirmation bias a little bit. And then you can just use, what I do is just use the Socratic method. You know, I'll just ask them questions.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, eventually it will turn into, you know, reductio ad absurdum argument, to the point that they're kind of stuck at the end, shaking their head, going, you know, what in the hell just happened there? Like, well, you just convinced yourself. I didn't have to do it for you, you know. And we mentioned earlier that the movement is really growing exponentially. It's not just, I don't think it's linear. I think it's really growing exponentially. And most of the voluntarists or anarchists, or I like to call myself what Bill Buper says, abolitionist, excuse me.
Me too.
Because I think it's a great line. I'm against all forms of human slavery. Which ones are you for? You know, it's fantastic.
Yeah.
<it's true. clears throat> But we create more people like ourselves. We don't create them. We help them to create themselves. And
I don't know about you now, guys. I have a production line in the back. So, I mean. Anyway.
Yeah, crank them out. But and now those people are out there witnessing and proselytizing, you know, and so that's why I am optimistic, because we have the truth on our side. We have the facts of history on our side, and it's actually starting to wake people up. And I don't know, man, when I wake up in the morning, I'm excited about maybe running across that one person that I can have that conversation with and plant one little seed in his brain. And if that's all I do all day, man, I consider that day a success. I'm happy with that. You know,
yeah, so. That's a great attitude to take, man. You know, I'm somebody that after I got out of my angry stage, I calmed down, but then I was still trying. I just drove myself a little batty trying to figure out every way I could help to make this state obsolete right away, and that drove me crazy for a while. And then I finally came to a realization that I didn't think I was ever going to get to see it. Like I came to this kind of acceptance where, and I to this day now, I still don't fully believe it anymore, because I get encouraged by just like the things you were saying, just like that, you know, those moments, those day-to-day moments where you make those connections and you see these other people waking up all around you. And even if it's just little steps at a, you know, little steps at a time, it's encouraging. So I've scaled back on it a little bit, but I kind of said to myself one day, yeah, you're never going to see it. And instead of getting depressed about that, where I've come across a lot of people who go through that stage where they get depressed about that, they are
happened to me like 2 nights ago.
Yeah, so. But yeah, it's not going to happen. It's never going to happen. And it's like, yeah, that can be depressing. And I thought it would kill me, but I actually found this weird strength in it. And it was, for me, it was kind of like, okay, let's just say I don't get to see the final result. Okay, that sucks. But I'm also part of a couple of generations here that's fighting against thousands and thousands of years of this crap. So to think that I would get to be part of the particular generation that actually got to make that happen is pretty freaking ballsy of me to be assuming that. So you know what? Maybe I take a step back and say, okay, I don't have to see it happen, but it's not going to get any closer if I don't do anything about it. So yep. I still got to go out there and try, because where a lot of people would give up at that instance, I said, no, I'm going to keep pressing forward because I at least, you know, I mean, the most I could do personally is give my daughters the tools and hopefully they use them and make the same, you know, come to the same or similar conclusions that I did. That's all I can really do because I'm not going to force anything on them either. I'm just going to give them the tools, you know, teach them to utilize logic and reason, you know, light years ahead of when I was taught. And, you know, hope for the best in that regard. But outside of that, I can't do anything other than, you know, play my little role in this. So instead of hoping and hoping and hoping and saying, oh, I want to see the state fall. Well, yes. Do I want to? Of course. Will I be upset if it happens while I'm still around? No. But I can just go out there and help chip away because for every person who says, I want there to be a change, but I either A, am too afraid to do anything about it because of the possible repercussions, or B, am not going to bother because I don't think it'll ever occur in my lifetime. You know, for every one of those type of people, we're that much further away. So I can't be that person. I can't be one of those people. I have to do what I can now. And, you know, just as corny as it sounds, you know, just be part of the change, man. Just go out there. And I live my life. I try to show other people what's possible without government, you know, by what I do with my life. You know, I took my business in a more agorist direction this year. I've been talking to my clients more openly about this stuff and just getting ideas out there and just trying to show people, hey, I can do pretty much most of the things that you think I can't do without government right now. It may be a little risky in certain situations, because the government hates competition, but
it does.
I can do, you know, I can still function and you can too. You just have to be willing to try and see, hey, wait a minute. It's not that bad. You know, and that's, like I said, for me, it, at first that depressed me, but then I kind of got over it and I was like, well, you know what? I'm okay with the idea of never seeing it, but I have to, in order to be able to teach my kids, I have to be as true to this idea as I possibly can. And I can't do that by not doing anything and saying, well, I'm not going to see it. So why bother?
Yeah. So, well, it's like the conclusion I came to the other night is like, it's with, like, we understand that these things are moral wrongs, you know, involuntarily taking from people or, you know, subjecting people to rules that they didn't consent to and all these other things that we stand for and these principles that we take to heart. And they're, you can't, just because you don't think you're making a significant impact, you can't turn away from a moral wrong. You know what I mean? So, like, if you believe in your heart that it is, in fact, immoral to tax people without their permission, if it's immoral to lord authority over people without their consent, you can't just turn around and then close your eyes to it and say, oh, well, I mean, whatever, I can't do anything about it, so there's no point in even trying. Like, you still have to. And that's the conclusion I came to, is even if it's the smallest contribution, you know, compared to everybody else, it's still a contribution. It's still something that's been done in this, to put it in the right direction.
Yeah, you know, sure. Yeah, I think that's a very, very good point, very valid point that I don't know about you guys. I can't speak for you, but at least for me, I feel like I have a moral compulsion to do this. And Jeremy, same thing with me. I don't do this for my health. I don't have to do this. You know, I'm retired. I live behind a locked gate down a private road. You know, government never touches me, you know, directly, except for, you know, my taxes and trying to evade the road pirates when I have to go to the store and things like that. But I do it because I want to leave I feel compelled to leave things better for my kids than I got them. And, well, I had like three things there that I wanted to say all together, but, you know, it really is, you're not going to see a stateless society probably in our lifetime, and that's okay. But at least when I go to bed at night, I sleep pretty good at knowing that I was true to myself and true to everyone else that I talk to, even if my ideas are wildly unpopular with a lot of them. They know in their heart of hearts that I never lied to them. And, yeah. You know, yeah. I think that's important. And I think that's a good example for our children to see that, mm-hmm. that, you know, one of my favorite quotes is from Thomas Paine, says, if there's going to be trouble, let it be in my day so that my children may live in peace. You know, if this is going to be the fight that we're going to have for personal freedom, for personal liberty, you know, people say, man, wouldn't that be dangerous? Yes. Freedom, liberty is wildly dangerous. But you know what's more dangerous than that? The state.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So, you know, is it something that's really worth fighting for and putting all of your effort into? I think so, at least for me. And if, you know, I'm only one out of a million people that are, you know, doing it, then that's okay too. You know, at least my contribution is there. So, I don't know. Just, I like to look at things in a positive way.
Yeah.
Yeah. It definitely helps, you know. Like I said, I've kind of had to. Oh, it's funny. People like us, we always talk about being against the initiation of force and stuff like that. But I've actually had to force myself to think more like that, because, you know, most people in my life, at least before I started, you know, openly calling myself an anarchist and an abolitionist, would tell you that I had a very pessimistic outlook on life. So it's very easy for me to see the negative in things and become negative. But I've had to. You know, it's a combination of, you know, being a dad and coming to these realizations kind of at the same time, because it was shortly after my kids were born that this whole thing started for me, which I actually count myself and them kind of lucky for, because they're going to hopefully get to bypass a lot of the BS that I had to go through, you know, because I knew about things a lot, or, you know, if I had waited even a couple more years, I would have already been teaching them stuff that might have been hard to get to break them already. But yeah, it helps to be positive, you know. Like I was saying before, it's easy to get discouraged, it's easy to get depressed, but I don't think that doesn't get us anywhere. And I think trying to stay positive really makes it a lot. It makes it a lot more bearable.
Sure. And that just reminded me of what it was that I brain farted on. But I tend to take the stoic approach to try to focus my emotional and mental energies to things that are actually within my sphere of influence and my sphere of control. And in my mind, any of the ancillary things that are going on in the world, geopolitical, whatever it might be, that I have no control over, I'm not going to give myself permission to invest any emotional energy into those things. You know, I've got a friend of mine who's just beating me up because he has to know who I'm supporting for president. And I'm like, you don't get it, do you? I said, man, I'm a voluntarist. I don't support any of them. He's like, well, you got to get the lesser of two evils. And I said, well, that's the difference. I don't support evil. And I'm not going to do anything to encourage them. And furthermore, talking about our kids, yes, even our children are going to be living under the thumb, under the heavy hand of government. But at least they will understand, and they'll have perspective on what's happening to them, and not just be another tax cattle.
Yeah,
you know, and that I think in and of itself gives them and teach them the ability to think, and explain to them the way things really are, and let them go. Your work is done. I think that's the best thing that we can do for our children, is just teach them the ability to have a good BS meter, if you will.
Yeah, I agree. You know, for, like I said, for me, I, like I said before, I, you know, there's certain tools I want to give my kids that I think were kept from me, intentionally by the system at large, not necessarily intentionally by my parents. They just didn't know. I hate to say they didn't know any better, because that kind of strips them of moral agency a little bit, but, you know, they grew up thinking this was the truth too. So it's kind of hard to pin all of it on them. But I always look at, I say a lot that, you know, there's four things I think that are purposely not taught in school, to keep people stupid, or at least to keep them docile to a certain extent, which is, you know, real history, obviously, economics,
yeah,
philosophy, and logic outside of the field of mathematics.
Yeah.
Those four things are Because for me, those were the four keys: learning about all that stuff, you know, relearning history and learning the things that I wasn't taught, and then learning different versions of what I was taught. You know, learning about economics outside of the one size fits all quasi-Keynesian bullshit that most of us were force-fed to be, you know, when most people utter the term, it's simple economics 101. That's what they're referring to. You know, when I learned there was other schools of thought to that, when I realized that philosophy was not this hoity-toity BS crap that it, because like I, when I was in school, it was, that was one of those things that was taught as an elective. But it was like degraded by pretty much everybody to be like something only certain girls and pretty much any gay guys would take.
How's the phrase go? Oh, what are you going to do with a philosophy major?
Well, life? Yeah, exactly. Like that. But that was the attitude that I was presented in school. And it was not very, you know, it was something, no, you don't want to bother taking that. Or, you know, just like economics. Oh, economics is boring. You don't want to deal with that. Like, but that's how it was presented, not just by my peers, but like even some of the faculty, like that's how they kind of directed you. So when I learned there was other schools of that, and then when I learned that logic wasn't just something you used in math, I was like, holy crap. Like,
yeah, it's an actual process, really?
Yeah, yeah. Like, I mean, like I understood the basis of it, but when I got started to delve deeper into it, and I was like, oh my God, like this is really complex. Like what the heck's going on? And then, but then after I reached that point, I was like, wait a minute, it's not that, because then once you get past a certain point, it's like, oh no, now I see why it all makes sense, because everything follows. So like, those are the four things. I want to give my kids those things. I want to give them those tools, say, this is what daddy wasn't given until much later in his life. I believe in you, and I'm going to give it to you now. I'm going to trust you with this information now and see where you can take it. Because like you said, Merrick, that's all we can really do. We can give it to them, you know, let them try to run with it and hope for the best.
Yeah, I think if you do that, not to cut you off, no, but a continuation of that thought, I think if you do that, that's about as good as you can do. And the chances of them coming out, you know, the way you would prefer to see them come out are pretty high.
Yeah.
If somebody asked me, I home educate my youngest son. And, you know, I use various methods. You know, I teach him the trivium method. Mm-hmm. And somebody asked me the other day, I get a lot of heat for that. You know, people don't understand home education. Why don't you just let the state do it? you don't know me very well, do you? But somebody asked me, they're like, well, you know, what are you going to teach him? I said, you know what I need to teach him for the rest of his life? If you told me I have 1 hour for the rest of his life to give him everything that he needs, assuming that he can read and do basic math and things like that, I would teach him about logic, and I would give him a smartphone. You know, show them how to use Google and go, there you go.
Well, I mean, because that's
go ahead.
No, I didn't want to cut you off, but it just made me chuckle because we were talking about, you know, critical thinking and logic and being able to reason your way through, you know, ideas and concepts. That's something that I'm very incredibly fortunate that my dad gave to me, and he blessed me with being able to critically reason. I just don't think he realized it would end up leading me down here. But yeah, no, that's
he taught you too well.
Yeah, well, that's the one great gift that he gave me in teaching me how to think and how to think logically and understand how things follow. He taught me the Socratic method.
Yeah,
and that's been my greatest boon ever since.
Sure, and if you'll notice, people who do possess the tools necessary to use critical thinking tend to have much more of a thirst for knowledge. You know, they're much more inquisitive and much more critical of just seeing what's coming in. And it just makes you ask yourself a lot more questions. You're like, I don't know, that one's not adding up.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I want to get in and start doing some research. Even if it's something that really has no bearing, I'm like, that sounds like baloney. Let me find out. Yep, that's baloney, you know?
Yeah. So,
and that is what's missing. It's hard to have a good moral basis if you don't have a sound philosophy. And if you've never been taught that, then, you know, that and then on top of that, you've never been taught how to critically think. Why would you do anything else than to sit around and watch, you know, The Simpsons reruns over and over and do nothing else? You know, well, I'm just waiting. I'm waiting on election day, so I go vote for Trump, whatever. okay. So yeah. I think that lack of a solid base of thinking really leads people down the road to apathy. You know, I make the illusion all the time to people, the analogy rather, that the word amusement from Latin, a means the opposite of to muse, to think. So all of these distractions, everything you're doing in your life, is you're just robbing yourself of the time that you could think. They're like, oh, I never thought about it that way. I'm like, yeah, that's kind of what I'm saying.
Yeah. Well, that's part of the challenge living in the technologically driven world that we live in, is there's so many things out there to make life easier and to keep your focus on them rather than introspection or research or anything else, that people just get, you know, drawn away from that. And trying to convince some people to just sit and think, it's like, God, why would I want to do that? That just sounds so boring.
Well, I mean, even Facebook does that. I mean, Facebook has been just this fantastic tool that we've had to, you know, get together in groups and talk about these ideas. But I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I can't tell you how many times I've just gotten lost in a sea of all this crap that's on my feed. And like, I end up doing nothing productive for 2.5 hours.
Yeah. Oh no. I've been there for.
I'm very, very guilty of that. Yeah. But I also use that as a tool for education.
Yeah. No. Me too.
Even the people. I think what I found funny is a lot of the people who still vehemently disagree with me, I still see them there. They're still reading it, and I'm like, that's all that matters. You know, as long as you don't leave me, just stay with me, buddy. And you know, eventually you'll start to come around. And I have seen that. That was actually another point that I really wanted to make earlier when I lost my train of thought. But this, I think, is out of the entire history of mankind, we are living in the most perfect time, for lack of a better term, with the best conditions to spread the idea of peaceful interaction.
I could not agree.
Because
more.
We have the history, the all of the information, the knowledge of the history of the world, you know, everything from everywhere is at our fingertips.
Yep.
And we have, for the first time, we have decentralized currencies that we can use, and things like Bitcoin, which are fantastic. You know, I think that in a number of years, people are going to see how the blockchain is much bigger than just Bitcoin as far as decentralizing a lot of the things in our lives. We have the internet. We have things like the Tor browser, you know, where we can maintain anonymity to be able to search for things that are out there that we wouldn't ordinarily be able to find, or maybe wouldn't even necessarily want other people to know that we were looking at. When throughout history have you had that? If you go back, I don't know, 500 years, the most expensive thing sometimes in someone's household was a book. Yep. Because, you know, a lot of them were handwritten. Well, go back further. What was that book? It was usually the Bible. And people didn't even have the Bible because they were so expensive, because they had to be done by hand. Mm-hmm. Usually, the Bible would be held by the church. And then they wouldn't teach people under lock and key. They wouldn't even teach people how to read, because they can say, no. I can read. I'll read it to you. I'll explain it to you. Yep. Says right here to... give us 10% of your loot and do what the king says and, you know, and so on and so forth. And look at from in the grand scheme of things, that's just a blip in time from that to where we are today. And I think that that's a great thing, man.
Absolutely. I could not agree more. The internet has been easily our greatest, like our greatest way to get the message out. I mean, I think it's been the best thing since the printing press, since we've been able to automate the production of paper and text on page.
Absolutely.
Oh yeah.
I mean, look what that did. We had the American Revolution with the printing press. Mm-hmm. Like I really can't even imagine what's going to happen, you know, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years down the line with what we have. Assuming we don't blow ourselves up first. That's
well, there's always that. It's always an option. But the power of the word is much more powerful than the sword. And what we have is the biggest microphone that we've ever had, ever. Yep. You know, we can literally, even a Joe Schmuckatelli nobody like me can talk to thousands of people like we're, you know, on the internet at any given time or on Facebook and actually be heard.
Yep.
I just, maybe I'm also a Luddite, but I'm still blown away by it. You know, the whole thing. It just really.
Oh no, I am too, and I grew up in it. I mean, I've had my parents had a computer in the house. You know, so from the time I can remember, my parents were both computer programmers. That's how they got started. They were computer science people. And it still blows me away to just take a step back and look at it and be like, we could do all of this stuff, and it requires literally zero effort, where 100 years ago this would have been inconceivable. Like, this would never have happened.
Oh yeah. Well, you it's dang public. Kids. You don't know how it was.
Yeah.
Back in my day, we'd have to fill out the postcard and mail it in that said, I am intrigued by your ideas and wish to subscribe to your newsletter.
Yes.
Yeah, well, I mean, back in your day, you could buy a 30-30 rifle from a Sears catalog. So, I mean, I don't.
Hey, not that old.
Yeah, we'll see. I actually, I'm starting.
I do have one of those.
the rifle and a Sears catalog.
one out of a catalog.
I'm starting to get a little bit up there. But I can remember a time before the internet. So it's funny because what you said there is so true. It's like I think the big thing is though, if you step back and look at it, because so many people.
Yeah, they don't.
Obviously the past couple of generations that have known nothing but this, you know, I guess, well, if you want to count, I mean, I don't know, what do they actually count a generation, 20, 30 years? I don't know. So this last generation, I guess, that hasn't known anything but this, then yeah, I can understand them not wanting to think about what it was like before, because they wouldn't know. But a lot of other people, like, you know, a couple generations before, they've gotten so wrapped up in it that they don't stop to think what it was like, other than to say, oh God, it's so much better, and then leave it at that.
Yeah.
But you know, it's definitely an extremely powerful tool. I say all the time that I think technology in general, the internet especially, can and probably will be our great savior, but can also be our most dangerous foe at the same time. You know, because for every person out there who wants to do something to make other people's lives easier, there's another person who wants to use the same technology to find a way to control people more. So we have to keep battling back and forth against that. Yeah. And for every bit of information, people like us, other people in alternative media sources or whatever can, for everyone who's out there trying to spread those messages, there's somebody else trying to spread disinformation to purposely discredit that person, you know? So it's definitely, like I said, it's a ridiculously powerful tool. I'm glad we have it at our disposal. And I do think that eventually it will help it, like, you know, like you guys said, if things don't blow up first, it will definitely help lead to the freeing of most of the world. I would like to say, you know, I would like to, well, I mean,
I would like to, I would like to think that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know, at
and
some
we
point.
Have, we have examples of that. It does make it harder to hide misinformation.
Yeah.
Think about, look at what Edward Snowden did, Julian Assange, and Bradley Manning.
Mm-hmm.
Now, those, you talk about the holy grail of state lies and secrets. I mean, they blew the lid off of construct tyranny.
Yep.
And I think that look at what Cody Wilson has done with Defense Distributed. I'm also a gun builder. I build AR-15s and AR-10s with no serial numbers, completely legal, just with, you know, using a mill and a lathe.
Mm-hmm.
And look at what he's done. It made it automated.
Yep.
Now you can just buy it off Amazon and, you know, push the button and you're cranking out guns. You know, when people clamor about, oh, this, gun control that, you know, if we could take away all the guns, then everybody would be safer. And my point on that is no, because now the technology exists and you can't take the pee out of the pool. So if you took away all the guns in the world, I would just build a gun, and now I have the power because I'm armed and you're not. And that really makes people go, you know, Yeah,
well,
he has a point
there.
Well,
yeah, but then we just have to take away the technology and then to just take
Well, and that's what they're doing. That's what they're doing now. The government's trying to shut down Cody Wilson from being able to release those files, you know, those drawing files, that people can use. But that's it's never going to happen. Like I said, the pee is in the pool. You ain't taking it out. And that's a good thing.
Yep.
All right. Well, I hate to leave you guys, but
no, sorry. Right. We should probably get wrapped up anyway. This was a lot of fun. I'm glad you guys were able to come on tonight.
And, yeah, glad you had me on.
Fantastic. I would love to do this again. So whenever you want to, if I can, I would love to be here.
Yeah. Well, we'll definitely try to set something up once the new year rolls around. Everybody, like I said at the beginning. I think this is going to air after New Year's, but, you know, it's New Year's Eve. Whoever ends up watching this, yeah, party. I just want to thank everybody who, has watched, subscribed, listened to our stuff, and continues to listen. We really appreciate it. It's been a lot of fun for the first year. We're looking, I know the other guys, they may not, been able to show up tonight, but, I know they are too, looking forward to the new year and, just keep trying to spread the message and, hopefully, plant some seeds, change some minds and, bring that freer world just a little bit closer. So this has been the Seeds of Liberty podcast. As always, you can find all our information at theseedsofliberty.com. And we'll see you next year. Peace.
Peace.